The next example that I like to do is a problem. Let G be a group and let H be a subgroup of G. For any fixed element X in G, define this set, X capital H, X inverse, to be the set of all products of the form X times little h times X inverse as H little h ranges over capital H. So you got a group G, that's the big group. You got a subgroup H. You could even start to draw a little diagram here. There's G. There's H. Where is X? X could be in H, it could be outside of H. In general, it's outside of H. Maybe this is X. Part A of this problem says that this set xHx inverse, which is again the set of all products of the form X times little h times X inverse, as little h varies over capital G, or excuse me, capital H, this is a subgroup of G. That's the goal of the first part of this problem. It's a pretty important thing. X is fixed. This is called a conjugate of H. Sometimes the conjugate of H equals H itself. In fact, if you think about it, it should make sense that if X were in H, then this set should equal H. Because if X is in H, then X times H times X inverse, as H varies over H, is always going to be in H as well, because H is a subgroup, so it's closed under multiplication and taking inverses. But it turns out to be a subgroup even when X is not in H. And it does turn out for certain subgroups H, this is important, for certain subgroups H, even when X is not in H, it equals H still. That happens sometimes. Which kind of makes some intuitive sense that you think, certainly if the group is abelian, then you could switch the H and the X inverse around and write this as X times X inverse times H. The X and the X inverse give you E. E times H is H. This would not give you anything different than H for any given H if the group is abelian. So certainly if the group is abelian, this is equal to H as well, even when X is not an H. But once more for emphasis, this sometimes equals H even if the group is not abelian. And that's actually an important situation that we'll come to, I think it's chapter 7, 8, somewhere in there. 9, actually. So this is an important idea, but we want to prove this is a subgroup. Let's just do the idea of the proof. So I won't write things out in excruciating detail. First of all, is it non-empty? X is fixed and H is a subgroup. H being a subgroup means it has at least one element, right? At least the identity. H being a subgroup of G implies the identity of G is an H, which means X inverse is in this set. By the way, that equals E. The identity is in the set, so the set's not empty. Okay, so that's the zeroth step, show the set's not empty. Should we try the one-step or two-step subgroup test? I think I'm going to do the two-step subgroup test. Once again, I could say let B and C be in here. I want to show it's closed under multiplication. What does it mean to be in there? You always have to go back to what it means to be in the set. What is the definition of the set? It's all products of this form. Again, x is fixed, h is varying over capital H. So B and C being in the set means there's, for each one of those, there's something in capital H, where B equals something like this and C equals something like this. But the H is not necessarily the same, of course, since B and C are not necessarily the same. Or you could call them, say, H1 and H2. Such that B equals xH1 X inverse and C equals xH2 X inverse. Now multiply. B times C will then be, we'll use the associative property for emphasis, though if you didn't, I wouldn't mark it wrong. In reality, you are using the associative property. I can rearrange the parentheses like this. X inverse times X is E. I get X times, and for put parentheses like this for emphasis, H1 times H2 times X inverse. To finish verifying closure under multiplication, I do need to note something here. What allows me to finish this verification to say this is an element of X, capital H, X inverse? What's the key fact that I need to get to that final conclusion based on the form of this? Yeah, H is a subgroup, so it's closed under multiplication. This is an element of capital H since H is a subgroup of G. That would be really important to remark. That's essential, in fact. What we're proving here is not true if H is not a subgroup. How about closure under inverses? B equals X, H1 X inverse for your arbitrary element B. What does that mean about its inverse? We can generalize the socks shoes property from last time. We could call it the socks shoes heavy boots property. Put on a pair of socks, then you put on your shoes. You got to go outside in the deep snow and you don't want your shoes to get wet. You put heavy boots over those so your shoes can fit in there. If you take them off, you have to take off your heavy boots first, then your shoes, then your socks. When I take the inverse of this product of three things, I have to take the inverse of each of these in reverse order. X inverse, inverse. The X inverse goes on the left. H1 inverse, X inverse. But it is a property of inverses that when you take the inverse of an inverse, you get the original element back. Hope that makes sense. And once again, this thing here, this entire thing, is an element of H since H is a subgroup of G. Therefore, this set, this conjugate of H is a subgroup of G when H itself is a subgroup of G. Subgroups are not just arbitrary sets, not just arbitrary subsets of groups. They have to be closed under multiplication and taking of inverses.